Good evening and welcome to the New York Society Library to this special evening on biography. I'm Jenny Lawrence, a longtime member and former trustee. Before we start, I'd like to give a brief biography about us, a library that has had a pretty long shelf life. We are the oldest in the city, founded in 1754, and in our 264 years, we've remained an enduring institution and cultural oasis, mostly because so many of our members and friends lend their support above and beyond membership fees. Please continue to give generously so books and writers and programs about books and writers will continue to flourish. As we begin, ask you to silence your cell phones and anything that might disrupt the corner bookstore. We appreciate it. Copies of our panelists' latest books are available for purchase from our corner bookstore friends just outside, and our panelists will be happy to sign copies afterwards. We have tonight with us three distinguished biographers. Judith Thurman is the author of Isaac Dinesen, The Life of a Storyteller, and Secrets of the Flesh, A Life of the Web. She's now a staff writer for The New Yorker, writing articles about books, culture, and fashion. Read her collection of New Yorker essays, Cleopatra's Nose, and you will find yourself under a biographer's spell. Her profiles of Yves Saint Laurent, Hillary Clinton, or Giorgio Armani are unforgettable, and much of her work focuses on the lives of writers from Edna St. Vincent Millay and Margaret Fuller to graphic memoirist Alison Bechdel. Edmund White is currently a professor of creative writing
in May.
In spirit. Among his 17 books are biographies of Jean Genet, Marcel Proust, and Arthur Rimbaud. In a collection called Arts and Letters, Writings on and Interviews with a Range of Cultural Figures, he creates vivid portraits of his subjects, from Bruce Chapman, Christopher Isherwood, and Robert Mapplethorpe to Vladimir Nabokov, Andre Pied, and George Eliot. In his forthcoming book in June, The Unpublished Vice, A Life of Reading. He remembers his life through the books he's read that formed his taste, shaped his memories, and amused him through the best and worst life had to offer.
Could you speak into the mic?
I'm sorry. Jim Atlas is author of Delmore Schwartz. Can you hear me now? Good. The Life of an American Poet and Fellow, a Biography, and the memoir, My Life in the Middle Ages, A Survivor's Tale. Under the Lipper Viking Penguin Lives imprint, he published 22 short biographies, pairing noted authors with subjects ranging from Napoleon to Rosa Parks. Jim was many years an editor at the New York Times, and his work has appeared in many journals. He's a longtime member of the library, and he's spoken in this room a number of times. His latest book, The Shadow in the Garden, A Biographer's Tale, is not just the backstory behind the making of his two biographies, but is also about biographers and their subjects through time. It goes back to Plutarch, known for his biographies of leading figures in antiquity, who wrote, "My design is not to write histories, but lives. And the most glorious exploits do not always furnish us with the clearest discoveries of virtue or vice in men. Sometimes a matter of less moment, an expression or a jest, informs us better of their characters and inclinations than the most famous sieges, the greatest armaments, or the holiest battles whatsoever. Here, the souls of men are for the first time the objects of a biographer's focus." Then there is a 17th century archaeologist, scholar, writer, and, yes, gossip, John Aubrey, who left behind manuscript accounts of such figures as Francis Bacon, Sir Walter Raleigh, Thomas Hobbes, or John Milton that went unpublished for a century and a half. In these portraits, Aubrey sought to raise the dead so that retrieving of these, quote, forgotten things from oblivion in some sort resembles the art of a conjurer who makes those appear that have lain in their graves many hundreds of years and to represent, as it were, to the eye, the places, customs, and fashions that were of old times. Biography is an art, the art of a conjurer. Now it's time to turn the evening over to the conjurings of Jim Atlas, Judith Thurman, and Edmund White, who will certainly reveal yet more about the biography of biography itself.
Thank you. Thank you all for coming tonight. Ed, I remember, and I'm sure you do too, that we've been on had a road show with this 14 years ago. Ed and I, and Francine Gray, went to Seattle and Portland to talk about the Proust lives, the Ed's biography of Proust. And you remember, it was an incredible experience. We filled opera houses. Hundreds of people showed up. It's like Pavarotti walking on stage. I mean, they were just like, the biographers have come to town.
People out there read.
Well,
they don't have anything else to read.
No, that's the thing. They read, but here they have a lot of different options. Like they say at American Airlines, we know you have many choices and some carriers. So we know you have, there are a lot of things that you could have done tonight. Anyway, I'm glad that Jenny has introduced our guests. And Judith is stepping in for Francine. And I say this in the spirit, I hope it will be understood, of tribute rather than mockery. But as an example of how New York is different from Seattle and Portland, I was in the subway the other day, and I saw a homeless person, and in his cart was Frederick Carl's biography of Faulkner, which was quite, I was so impressed. If I'm saying, what do you think of it? Jay Perini's is better. And then I was afraid he'd come back and say, well, I'm waiting for Carl Rawlinson's two volumes. But it was very impressive. And the library here, as Jenny mentioned, and as others I've been talking to tonight confirm, the library is a great oasis for literature and really, in particular, for biography. I've been coming here since the early 90s, before there were laptops. And I actually, among my achievements, there aren't many, but one I'm really proud of is that I was the pioneer in bringing laptops, breaking down the barrier, bringing laptops into this library. And now, of course, everything has changed. If you don't get to the fifth floor research room by 10 o'clock in the morning, you don't get a seat. It's just packed, and people are now downstairs, and it's become a whole, I mean, it's still a joy to work here, but I feel like it's been discovered. And I'm sorry I wrote an article for New York Magazine talking about my favorite secret place in New York was here. I didn't do it any good, obviously. But Ed, I've read just about all of your books, but I was looking the other day, browsing in stacks for a Virginia Woolf book, and right next to it, I saw a book of yours, your 1994 collection of essays, the Burning Library. And I was so excited by this. I thought, you just can find anything here. You wander around, you're looking for Virginia Woolf, and there is Edmund White. A tremendous collection of essays, and including one I hadn't read called, maybe we can talk about this at some length, called On Becoming a Model for Male Smut.
Oh, great.
Male smut?
No, I won't talk about that.
It's great, it's brilliant. Anyway, this editor of the volume says that he sees, this is 1994, that he sees Edmund primarily as a novelist, but I've always seen you in essence, a biographer. And I'm proud to have published your Rimbaud and your Proust biographies. But I'm curious, when did this bring up so many genres? Where do you turn out to, where does biography feature in your group?
Well, can you hear me? Should I talk into that?
Yes.
Yeah. I was living, I moved to Paris in 1982 and I stayed there for 16 years. And in 1985, my New York editor asked me if I would like to write a biography of Jean Genet, who had just died, 1986, he had just died. And I said, you mean there isn't one? And he said, no. And I said, oh, well, I'll do it. Little realizing what a biography is. I mean, and like 4 years later, my editor was saying, how's it coming? I said, oh, I'm halfway through. I hadn't even started. And I was in New York for a moment, and I thought, if I just step in front of that bus, I won't have to write or give back the money. And but then I met a marvelous researcher who, a French researcher who was the world's greatest expert on Jean Genet, and a wonderful person, became one of my best friends. And he sort of organized me. And he said, in order to write a biography, the first thing you have to do is to make a chronology. And you just make a year-by-year chronology and fill it in as you learn things. And that was a wonderful help. Then he himself had done research on all the arrests that Genet had undergone, including in little tiny towns, for using the wrong train ticket. I mean, he would adapt his train ticket so it wasn't just for the next town, but for Marseille. And France, until World War II, was really a 19th century country. And the punishments for things like stealing, I mean, his biggest crimes were stealing an autograph of François Premier, or some fabric from a department store, off to prison for several years. You know, I mean, all my young friends in Paris now steal all the time, and they're bourgeois, and all they do is cry, and the guy calls the mother, and there's no punishment. But in those days, you went to prison, and that's how I got into it, and it was an amazing experience because I had lived in Paris, but I knew nothing about France, and I only knew about a tiny elite, I guess you'd call it, of writers and editors, and suddenly I had to delve into the prison system, into the colonial system, and Genet was a foundling, so I had to go into that, and I even got somebody, well, the Minister of the Interior was a friend of mine, so I got him to contact a woman to read me a secret dossier over the phone because she couldn't let me see it. I mean, because apparently Genet had a living brother, and so the dossier of foundlings wasn't allowed to be revealed to anybody. But I needed that information. And I played so many dirty tricks. There was this very strange woman who had helped Genet write the screens, his play. And she refused to see me because Genet had said no biographies. And so she was following his will. So I hired a girl who could speak perfectly good French to pretend to take French lessons from her for a year. And then introduced me, the worm, into the apple. And you know, so, but I'm sure you did all these kind of dirty tricks
too.
No,
never.
I'm shocked.
You learned Danish to write your...
Yeah, that wasn't a dirty trick, though. No, there are lots of dirty... I once wrote writing about the difference between fiction and biography. I said, fiction is the art of high-minded betrayal, and biography is the art of dirty-minded fidelity. And it's sort of true. And you do... I once was desperate to talk to Martha Gellhorn, who had been married to Colette's stepson and lover, Bertrand de Jouvenel, and she wouldn't see me. And my friend Donna Tartt, the writer, was in London with her then boyfriend, Nicholas Shakespeare, and they were very good friends of Martha Gellhorn. So they went over to her house, and they all got quite drunk, and Donna would run off to the bathroom and take notes in the secret and send them to me. Yeah, you do resort to whatever subterfuge you can.
Well, you realize, I mean, in my case, I realize that so many of these people who had been friends of Genet's were in their 80s and 90s.
Yeah.
If they didn't tell their story, nobody would ever know it. And one man who I interviewed was Diaghilev's secretary, Boris Kokhnov, who had been in lover, I guess had been with Diaghilev since the 20s. And he refused to see me, no biography. But he, but I got a bunch of my friends who were his mutual friends to invite him to dinner and get him, and just, I told everybody, you have to stick to the subject of Genet all night. And so I was taping it away.
With Dennison, there was another hurdle, which was that there was a Danish writer who had been, was a friend of hers, and she had promised him that he could be her biographer. He was paralyzed. He never actually published anything. And 18 years had gone by when I showed up. But her secretary, Clara Svensson, was still very reluctant to break this pact with the Vigo. And she put me through all kinds of strange tests. She gave me some sort of document of absolutely no rules for some meeting that Dennison had spoken at. And then she wanted to make sure that I was not a pretender, and I told her that I could speak French and Spanish, and she took me to a restaurant where the waiter was Spanish to see if I could really speak Spanish. And so that it took an entire year of waiting and going to the Royal Library and before I got permission to use the archives. Knuckle whitening year of suspense because there was no book without the archives.
I think it's hard for Americans to understand this reluctance to speak on the part of Europeans. Because in America, you just call somebody up. I call up Black Panthers, who you would think in principle would hate me. But blah, 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 they tell you their whole story over the phone. And because Genet was a defender of the Panthers. And I had the same luck with the Palestinians, who were his other group. But Americans, with real French people, they're almost like Japanese, that you have to know an intermediary who introduces you to somebody else. And I had this friend, and she was the one I fobbed off this girl with French lessons. And she said, Madame Thévenin said, oh, Monsieur White was here today, and I opened the top drawer, but I don't know if I'll open anymore. By the end, she had become my best friend, and I had seen x-rays of Genet's kidneys.
I want you to know, by the way, that I did not have a question prepared about the trips.
Oh, yeah.
This is something you guys have brought in suddenly.
My son has that guilty conscience. The first thing that bubbled up.
Wow. But tell me, I'm curious about what you read to prepare for this book. How did you know? I looked at your book today, which is just an amazing object, hundreds and hundreds of pages long in beautiful prose,
with thousands of footnotes. Where did you learn to do this?
Well, the first book, I had no idea how to do anything. We were writing books. You were ahead of me by a few years, writing Delmore Schwartz when I sort of started Denison, and you and Jean Strauss, another good friend of ours, was writing her biography of Morgan. And all of these books took us, my Denison took 7 years, and Jean's took 10, and I had no idea. I was an incompetent. Why my editor thought I could do this, I still have no idea. And I remember that I never went to graduate school. I was not an academic. And so I decided 3x5 cards would be very important. This was before computers. And I did have one eventually towards the end of Denison. So I put everything on a 3x5 card, and I had the instinct to footnote every quote that I took. And if you don't do that, you're lost. Now you're not, because you're doing it on the computer. But in those days, you were lost, because you would never find it again. You know, you had to do that.
Oh, it's under the Marvel frog over there.
No, exactly. But then I read Leon Edel's biography of Henry James,
yeah,
and that taught me how to write a biography. Because the point, one of the first things, when I started writing, I was swamped. We won't even need not go into this, the depression, the details of the depression. But I misunderstood that you write a book in chapters. I've never written a long book either. You don't write a book in chapters. In a biography, what Leon Edel taught me was that you write it in short, interlocking, shapely sections, and they can be 1,000 words or 700 words or a little bit longer. And that way you can breathe. You can establish a narrative that has a pace. And it's funny, I was thinking of Proust when it was the centenary of the publication of Swan's Way. There were readings all over New York, and I was one of the readers, and I thought, my French is fluent, I thought I could do it in French. And I was reading, I got the Madeleine passage. But if you read Proust aloud, you need the trained breath of an opera singer. You do. You. And I couldn't do it in French. But it's that biography reminded me, it reminds me of the effort of biography, the breath that you have to, the long breath, the long breath, long distance breath you need. And that you learn, that sort of, you get that stamina, you do it by you know, the marathon running you do. But it was Leon Edel who taught me how to do it.
Yeah, it's 5 volumes, and it's a thrilling book. I remember
thrilling.
He said biography is the costliest labor on this earth. But it's interesting to me, which I've only just recognized now, that you're both steeped in French culture. So really, you learned from a different source, though I'm sure people like Edel and Painter and the other great American English biographies were important to you. Somehow,
Painter didn't interview anybody.
Who?
Painter, the biographer, the first biographer.
Yeah.
Not one person, because he couldn't speak French.
Right.
Well, he couldn't speak French.
No, he couldn't.
That shows up. But
so wait. So he wrote the biography of Proust without being able to read Proust in French.
He could read, but he couldn't speak. And he. In a way, Painter's all the best lines in everybody's memoirs. I mean, he read everybody's memoirs, but he had the chance to meet many of the people that Proust knew, but he didn't do it.
Now, the biographer spends many, many years on these projects, and that gives us ample time to change our minds about our subjects.
I think the throwing yourself under the bus was the apt.
Throw them under the bus.
But how
does that dynamic work? Do you begin in adulation and end in disapproval or even despair?
In my case, I chose writers I actually admired.
Oh, that's a good idea.
And I admired them more and more the more I studied them.
But what about them as men?
Horrible, all of them.
Yeah, well, that's a real issue, isn't it? Because it's one thing to read the work and appreciate the work, but then the more you know about the person, the more troubling it becomes.
You know,
it can become.
I I never suffered under any illusions, maybe about Proust. And I think Proust was the nicest one of them all. But he could be pretty horrible too.
Yeah, sure.
But Rimbaud was a total bastard. And certainly Genet was no
picnic.
What about Colette?
Well, Colette was no picnic, and my love of her work never faltered, and I think you go through like the stages of mourning, or it's the stages of adolescence. You grow up and you have to separate yourself psychologically to do this outer view of the reader. The reader should not be involved in this process. But you have to go through this separate, you idealize first, and then you reject and you rebel, and you want to squash them and batter them and expose them for their hypocrisies and their failings. And then there's a reconciliation of you with, this is all due with yourself, of course, poor subject is not doing anything. And then you achieve a kind of maturity in relationship to the subject that you have to fight for, you struggle for. And then all the scaffolding scaffolding both technical and emotional that you have had to erect, the scaffolding of theories and isms it's imposed, externally imposed notions upon this life, and the scaffolding of your own emotional, complex emotional feelings about the subject, you can finally take it down in the last draft. But until then, it's pretty ugly to look at, like all of the buildings in New York at the moment, the scaffolding. You can't really see it until the end.
Do you feel that there were moments when you thought that your subject would be sort of permanently elusive, that you would not be able to? I mean, the more one gets into these projects, the more one realizes that as Henry James said, I'll quote him again, you can't know the last word about any human heart, and yet that's your job.
It is, but you also, the horror is the more you know, you don't know anything, and that lasts for a long time.
I had a funny experience. Somebody asked me after I was 4 or 5 years into the Genet, why did Genet, who wrote novels exclusively about homosexuality, never put any homosexuals on stage in his many plays? And I said, I blurted out, oh, he was embarrassed. And then 3 days later, I read an interview he gave to a Spanish publication called Triunfo, where he said, I would be too embarrassed to show a homosexual.
So you knew it. You knew him so well that you just
felt it. But that's the good example. But the bad example is I interviewed a French photographer who had covered Genet when he was wandering around America. And he said, I don't want to talk about Genet. I'm so disappointed. And I kept pressing him. And finally he said, well, he danced in a pink peignoir for the Black Panthers. And I thought, this is impossible. I mean, Genet would never do anything like that. And so I just dismissed the guy as crazy. Then a year later, Angela Davis said to me, oh, I love Genet. He was the original gender bender. I was with him when he dressed in a pink peignoir.
Well, one of the moments that were the hardest to be with Colette was when I was kind of deep into the history of France between the two wars and the virulent anti-Semitism both of the 30s and later of the war period in France. And I found, there was a Gringoire, there was a journal that started out being published by Joseph Kessel, and it was literary, and it wasn't anti-Semitic. Kessel was a Jew. And then it became increasingly anti-Semitic. And Colette, during the war, with the Jewish husband, published a work there. And she was an anti-Dreyfus, she and her husband were anti-Dreyfusards during the Dreyfus Affair. They were very, in many ways, this radical woman was very right-wing and conservative, and that was one of the many paradoxes. I guess for
me. And another very disturbing thing about her is that her big anti-Semitic novel, Julie de Carnion, is her most beautiful novel.
I disagree with you on that, but yes, that was the one that was published, serialized in Gringoire.
Yeah.
And And then I had trouble with Colette as a mother. I had a little child. I was the mother. I was the single mother at 40 of a young child. And Colette was had her only child at 40. And she was the world, well, it's a competitive category, world's worst mother. She was way up there. And her daughter, who was a lesbian, Colette disapproved of her daughter's lesbianism, having herself been, of course, a lesbian and having a very public long affair with several people, but Missy in particular. And so I guess what I learned, it was the paradoxes of Dinnison's character were structured more as a duality, as a sort of force field of opposite qualities and beliefs. But in Colette's case, it wasn't a duality, it was just a paradox, an incredibly charged paradox. You couldn't sort it out neatly. You just had to sort of digest it.
What about Isak Dinnison?
Well, she, you know, she was the ironies. Once you, I think that every life has, for the scaffolding purposes, has a dialectic. There are two poles that they attract and repulse each other. And in her case, it was Kierkegaard's two poles, the aesthetic and the ethical, which was the huge culture battle of her times and her generation. And it took me a long time to understand that. And once I did, not that everything magically fell into place, that never happened, but it really just helped me to, gave me an understanding of what was going on with her. But with Colette, those poles, I didn't find them in such a neat way.
Was there a moment, or is this too mystical, of revelation? You suddenly have a flash of insight and understand all?
No, there wasn't one sort of general moment like that. There were many, many small ones.
I remember when Colette met Proust, she called him a little yid.
Yeah,
petit humain.
Yeah, petit humain. Yeah, exactly.
So I guess the issue is, how do you can't judge. Judgment is not part of our work, I don't think.
But you have to transcend it, because you do, you're human.
Well, of course you're doing it, but what you really need to be doing is extending this empathy, which is can be quite a challenge.
Yeah, that I think that's it.
And so you have this experience where you begin to, if you're fortunate, you begin to get them, you begin to understand them, but there's this constant work of forgiveness.
Yeah, one of the things that occurred to me in writing the Genet biography is it seems to me so many biographies are kind of Freud-lite in the sense that they find some childhood trauma which casts a shadow over the rest of the life. And in Genet's case, he was brought up as a peasant in the heart of France in extreme poverty, and you think, okay, this is the formula for a bigot. He loved all outcast people. He was a great defender of the Panthers and the Palestinians. I mean, he kept transcending himself again and again. He was not a Freudian case. He was almost a mystical case.
But you never met him.
I could have, but I didn't.
You didn't want to.
He didn't want to. He hated white people. He hated Americans. No, he hated white people. He hated Americans. He hated Christians. He hated writers. And he hated the bourgeoisie. So
he hated it. I do all of those.
All of them.
I guess.
Oh, and homosexuals. He hated.
Oh, God. Perfect storm.
Yeah.
I guess the one thing that Colette and Dinnison have in common that was one of those revelations, it was one of the key revelations, except that, is that they both wrote endlessly about their own lives, in which memoirs and you know, sort of autobiographical they see, in which they just lie through the nose, whereas if you want to find the truth about them, you have to find it in fiction. Mm-hmm. And Colette, he gave me the key herself in the epigraph to The Break of Day, which is, I'm hiding in plain sight. And she was hiding in plain sight. But I didn't, you just like Out of Africa is not Dinnison's best work, not close to it. It's not, it's fantastical. It's a version of her life in Africa that she didn't in fact live. So I think that in both their cases, the fiction is much truer than the memoir.
I think Colette is always trying to seduce the reader. I think the reader is a young man, probably, that she's trying to seduce as she seduced her 16-year-old stepson. But at one point in one of her 83 books, she's saying...
you know the number, bravo.
she's saying something kind of unappealing about herself, and then she says, "But I will draw a veil across this to spare the feelings of the young reader."
Well, tell us about, if such a thing exists, the fun part. we're buried in the stats, we're sitting in our room, we're crawling on the floor, there are no cards, we're not speaking to anybody for days at a time, we're suffocating from hatred of our subject and boredom. And where's the inspiration, which is clearly there because your books are so incandescent?
I think it comes at the very end. It's like a shooting ratio of 10 to 1 or 40 to 1. It's that, you know, you spend, in my case with Dinesen, 7 years. So I spent six and a quarter years in almost total misery and paralysis and fear and loathing and all the rest of it. And then when I had a first draft from beginning to end, and I had the sentences on the page and I could go back and tinker with them and polish them, and you couldn't pry me away, you couldn't talk to me, I was in a little cottage out in on Long Island, it was bliss. Then the words start coming from the air. You're not slugging, you're not fighting your own thick-headedness, they're just there. And that to me was the excitement.
What you're doing is you're writing.
Then you write, that's when you really write. You write the whole thing in 3 months in the end.
Yeah, the exciting moment for me in my little Proust biography was I was writing on the plane from New York to Paris, and I was sitting next to a nice lady, and we started chatting, and she said, "What do you do?" And I'm a writer, and you're writing Proust. And she says, "Oh, I'm the Princess Caramel Chimay." And her great grandmother was one of the main characters in Proust.
Did you fall off your seat?
No, she told me a wonderful anecdote. She said that that I've never seen in anything else, that her great grandfather, who was the Duc de Guermantes character, came out of his house one day and he found his footman sobbing. And he said, "Why are you crying?" And he said, "Oh, because Monsieur Proust died." And he said, "Oh, did you know him?" "Oh, yes, he used to come by every morning after you gave a party and ask me who was there, what people said, and who went home with whom. And he'd always give me very big tips." This was an economy class.
There's a moment.
I just remembered that I mentioned it.
Okay.
It was in August 68 at the Chicago Convention.
Oh, yeah.
And I was there in my capacity as a soldier of the left and dodging tear gas canisters. So we were in Lincoln Park, and who should come toward me but Ginsberg?
Burroughs,
right, and which is a name, and I was stupefied. I mean, I'd never really even seen a literary person at that point. So of course I rushed up and introduced myself to Mr. Ginsberg, and Genet's giving me this fixed stare, and then he turns to them and says, I was 18 years old.
Well, when Genet was in Chicago in 1968 at the Democratic Convention, Ginsberg thought, since they were both gay, they should go to bed together. So Janae was always game for everything. So they went to bed, and neither of them could get it up. So Janae being friends, being realistic, said, "Oh well." And Janae said, "No, let's hug." And Janae said, "Ugh."
Well, if you write about a French person, you eventually hear, you know, wonderful things. And I went to see a 93 or 4-year-old lawyer who had been the private maître aux jeunes. He'd been the private secretary to Henri de Jouvenel, and he was the age mate and friend of Bertrand de Jouvenel. And he was the last, was one of the last people alive who'd really known them back when. You have millions of people who knew Colette when she was old, but he knew her when she was young, 40-ish, and when Bertrand was a boy, and then he knew them in the period of the affair. And I said, I remember saying to him, Maître Jean, how old was I at the time? I don't know, 45 maybe. And I said, you know, I can understand, of course, Colette's fascination with Bertrand, this beautiful, luminous 16-year-old who also has the attraction of being her husband's son, the unfaithful husband's son. But what did he see in this fat woman of 50? And he bridled. And he said, "Attention, madame, 45, c'est pas 50." Attention, madam, 45 is not 50.
And Colette herself said, you go into your 50s young and you go out of them old.
Yeah, she did. 50 was the turning point. She was actually 46, it was 46. But he said, "Attention, 46, c'est pas 50." And I've never forgotten that, and I didn't double over, but I wanted to.
What do you do about the issue of what's true and what you think is true? This is a problem.
That's a central problem.
Yeah, I had this problem in writing.
You write about this so brilliantly.
Well, thank you. I lived it, writing about Bello. He would say something, and I would know instantly if it was true or not true. But what am I going to do with my footnotes? I can't say,
I believe this is
what's my source? I just know. You can't do it that way. But and often, of course, we have the documentation. But you begin to develop this instinct.
You do. You can only call it an instinct. It's like the heft of something. I to describe it as sort of people who pan for gold, and you hold the nugget in your hand, and you know whether it's gold or not. And it can be wrong. You are sometimes wrong, but when you spend years with somebody, minutely attuned to them, minutely attuned the way you can't be even with a partner or a child, because it's too, because it's also one way. You get to know their the new word, which is now so popular and important. You get to know their BS, and it has patterns.
Yeah, absolutely. We'll talk about the sensitive issue in a minute, four questions. But was there anyone you wanted to write about that you never did?
I wanted to write about Baudelaire, but then I thought there are perfectly good biographies of him, and he's been long dead, so that there was no interviews to do, no primary research.
You know, after Dinison, I had the unbelievable, not unique, but almost unique, good fortune of taking on a life for which there was no biography. There was one sort of ditzy memoir by a society lady, which was based on nothing. And so the archives had never been sorted through. I was the first person to go through them. And that was such a gift. It was such an extraordinary thing that trying to find another life that would have that scope, that the unknown, that would be so unknown. Also, it was just so exhausting that after Colette, I wanted to write about Colette, and I did. And then afterwards, everyone said, "Well, what are you going to do next?"
They do that, yeah.
And we discussed my writing Cleopatra for you briefly.
We did. What happened?
I don't know what happened. I think I was working with them.
Yeah, ran out of money. Yeah.
But then Stacey shifted. Greatest Cleopatra, that's a wonderful book. So.
That's right. So the question is, now what? Are some of us up here retired biographers? Or are we biographers? on sabbatical.
What if somebody wrote your biography?
Oh, God! What a catastrophe. Anyway, as all people say about, of course, it's preposterous for so many reasons, but people are always saying, oh, my life has been completely ordinary. Everything's ordinary. What is there to know?
But ordinary lives, I've always loved Diane Johnson's Lesser Lives for that very reason.
Yeah, that's great.
There are great biographies of Lesser Lives. I think the writing the New Yorker profile is biography in miniature. And it's not that I'm really retired from, I'm retired from the long form, but not from the short form.
Well, you know, I think in many ways that's a good thing. The long biographies are mandated. It was the first one, if it's where you have to, where it requires a correction of some kind. But of course I'm, as a publisher, enamored of short biographies, and they have been popular at different periods.
They take almost, they take as much work in a funny way.
Do you feel that?
Not quite as much work. I mean, there's not all the elaborate documentation required, but a life like Genet's, where he lived all over the world, including Japan, and where he had an enormous impact on Japanese politics, for instance. You know, researching all of that is not the easiest thing in the world. But I've written short little biographical essays about people for the New York Review of Books.
The one thing, my anxiety has always been that I feel I don't have the authority to say something unless I know pretty much everything, which you, for the New Yorker, of course, that's not possible. You're trying to do something in two months or 3 months, sometimes a bit longer, but often not. And so that the anxiety of what you don't know coming back to haunt you and bite you and humiliate you is always very strong, and I think that's part of why it took me so long to write those two books.
But it's always longer than you think it's going to be.
Yeah.
I remember when I...
And we haven't mentioned money. You run out of money.
Well, you do run out of money, absolutely. And I remember my then agent, when I was signing the contract to write Bellow, he said, how long is this going to take you? And I said, 10 years, a decade. And he said, you can't say that. Okay, you write a book that's going to take you 10 years. I said, okay, let's say 4 years. So we wrote in 4 years, but of course, 11 years later, I was. So, well, maybe we should ask, open the floor to questions. Have I said that you won the Penn Bellow Prize?
No, yesterday. On.
Ed White,
Penn Bellow.
Yes.
And his Mr. Bellow, I was thinking, would turn over in his grave.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, well, it's not up to him anymore. So do people want to ask questions? Yes.
You just talked about the anxiety of what you don't know when you're writing. When did it hit you hardest, and how did you get around it?
Well, it hits you hardest about a couple of years in when you give yourself a break in the beginning. Of course, you don't know anything. And it hits you hard every time you read something new that contains information that you yourself don't have. Mm-hmm. Where did they get that? And how come I don't have a note even to go look there for it? Sort of like the way Colette describes aging, although in a better sense, it's an all uphill, up, 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 and then there's this kind of plateau, and then you're on the descent side when you, know a lot, but.
You mean when you're aged?
You've climbed the peak, you know pretty much what there is to know, you know what's out there that you can't get to, in the locked caskets in someone's attic, and you have to let that go, you're not going to get it. So you feel confident that you know what there is to know. At that point you can.
But in terms of documents, isn't it the case that one can always find more?
That's true, you can always find.
And what about, I feel sorry for the people who are working on someone whose papers won't be unsealed.
Right.
Until,
I don't remember what kind of
The one thing I wanted to do and couldn't, I tried in Paris, was to get into Colette's police dossier.
Wow. You got into her character.
You got into
her. Because of the Minister of the Interior.
Yeah. Yeah, it was too bad.
Everything
it's like a banana republic, you have to know somebody.
Well, I remember going I actually stayed with this person in Chicago who was a friend of, actually she'd been deeply in love with Bello, and I stayed with her a few times. She was, her mother was friends with my grandmother. I felt very familiar with her, and I'd sleep in the guest room, and she'd give me ice cream and so on, and she's an important person. But one time I showed up there, and I said, you must have Bello's, you must have his letters. And she said, actually, he showed up the other day and took them away. And I just had a fit. I said, as if she couldn't do whatever she pleased. I said, how could you do that to me? Right. Now I'm going to have to go negotiate with him for 2 years to get them back. And there was this one letter left. He left a little note for me saying, dear Zita, for that was her name, dear Zita, I really don't approve of this book of Mr. Atlas's at all, and I feel like he's trying to bury me in Woodlawn Cemetery in Chicago, and don't give him any letters. But then he himself gave me hundreds of letters. It was just
control freak. What's interesting, another issue that we haven't touched on is what if you, I mean, Genet's books were all called novels, but people refer to them as autobiographies, like Journal of the Thief, but they are novels. But you'll sometimes catch him in a lie, like he'll say, I spent the two worst years of my life in Spain. He was only in Spain 2 months. Mm-hmm. But then I tried to write, in my book I said, if you're in the middle of the Depression, you're a vagrant, you have to beg for hours to get an onion to eat, that will feel like 2 years.
Yeah.
But also they do.
Yes.
I was wondering if you could talk a little bit about how you take all of this research, all this material, and shape it into a narrative with a theme and an organizing principle, so it's not just first this happened, then that
That's
happened,
a great
then
question.
That happened.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
That's the challenge. I mean, if you... I've sometimes, when I've talked to students and I've read them my first drafts of an essay, obviously not of a book, there's such a grotesque difference between your first stabs at something and then the final version of it. You just keep going, you bat your head against the brick wall until it bleeds. You rewrite, and then it becomes clear. You see where the ugly bits are. You see where it's not tracking. You see where it's unshapely, and you carve and you peel and you stab and you cut and you shape. And it just takes. That's what takes so long. I think that's my case anyway.
We are really masochists.
Yeah.
I found it intriguing that you said that the fiction tells the truth. So I would be interested in a couple of examples from Colette where you felt her fiction told you the truth.
Well, I'm thinking more of the things that don't tell the truth, but for example, in her writing about her mother, her memoirs of her mother's, in my mother's house, their relationship was so much more ferocious and competitive and possessive, and she does it, this wonderful earth mother. And then you read Cito's letters to Colette, and it's an entirely different relationship that emerges. I think the book of hers in which she reveals herself most profoundly is La Naissance du Jour, Break of Day, Break of Noon, Break of Day, sorry, Break of Day, which all really should be called Birth of Day, which it is in French. I don't know why it's translated that way. And it's really the first postmodern it's meta. It's the first postmodern novel. And it's exceptionally, she wasn't very self-analytical at all. But she is in that book. She's really reflecting on herself, and it's a play of mirrors, and I think that is probably her most autobiographical work of fiction.
I'm going back to the organization, but you said you don't organize it in chapters, but in long breaths.
Long breaths, yeah. Mm-hmm. Sections.
Sections.
So maybe there'll be three or five or nine or more within a chapter, and they, so you can deliver, then you can move. You know, they're like the segmented cars on one of these New York buses. They sort of wiggle. You literally have wiggle room that way.
What can you name a couple of biographies that were influential, that were models to you in trying to figure out how to do this?
This was later. The great biography of Dr. Johnson. The great biography of Dr. Johnson.
Boswell.
No.
Oh,
Bates, Jackson Bates.
Yeah.
Sewell's biography of Emily Dickinson.
Yeah.
Leon Adel's biography of Henry James. Phyllis Rose's biography of Virginia Woolf was very helpful to me.
I know, isn't it?
And there's some writers whose biographical prose acts as kind of skids and helps you get your own boat in the water for some reason. And Phyllis Rose, that book was helpful to me in that way.
By the way, since we're mentioning Phyllis, you know her book, The Shelf, which is about stacks here in this library, and she took a photo book. Genius, and told us what was in those books and what they were. So she's also a great proponent for that. What about you? I just wanted to ask you about.
Well, I'm a huge fan of Hermione Lee,
and. But you had written your books before.
But I'd written my books before, but.
Me too, by the way. That's why she would have been on the list.
I don't know. I never felt like I really knew what I was doing. One of the things I felt, sort of answering your question, was that I was really proceeding chronologically, but every once in a while, I would have to stop and talk about a whole subject. Genet was in a reform school for boys called Maitre, and he wrote about it all his life. It was really the most poetic inspiration in his life. And so that in 1949, he gave a radio broadcast when they were threatened to close down that reform school for being too cruel to the boys. And he said, "Oh no, you must never close it down. That's what makes poets."
That's it. Graham Robb, I think, is a great biographer.
Graham Robb.
Richard Holmes is a great biographer.
Yes.
His work really helped me too.
Richard Holmes. So are there others? One more, we'll take one more, yes.
I have a question. The economics of it really don't work now, but maybe in the future, is that I've always thought biography was perfect for kind of multimedia. Because as you go along, you have your raw material, and that raw material can be their books, interviews that you're gathering. But more and more, that raw material is going to be in a digital, it can be audio, it can be video of the subject. And it becomes a tool to also use to write the book. So in some ways, I'm surprised I haven't seen there must be a 23-year-old out there who's sort of creating this biography that puts all this stuff together. And
of somebody living, you mean?
Yeah, I mean, you're not going to, I don't know if there's record. I guess there's still recordings of Grant or Lincoln, but
there are hours and hours of film on Genet where he was televised, And I found those extremely helpful because you could see, for one thing, you saw what a funny guy he was. He was always, everything you might read a transcript of, you would assume it was serious, but he was really always joking. And I mean, that's true of like James Merrill, the poet, is that he's the funniest poet. But audiences don't permit themselves to laugh unless they see him do it.
At literature, they don't laugh.
Well, his poems seem so so hieratic, and but if you see him read them, he's always cracking up.
So it sort of sounds like a documentary, though, very well done documentary. And there are some literary documentaries that are lives of writers on that have long, you know, several parts in which that is. And the interviews that you distill, otherwise would distill into your book, are on film.
Yeah, I was just going to say, though, isn't really a biography in some way a case history, though? That is, that you really are looking at it, and you're analyzing it, and just seeing somebody do it, you wouldn't sort of break through to their psyche.
But a case history is sort of a pejorative word in the sense of, it is too. No, to me, I guess it still is in the sense that you can't pathographize, you can't sort of make your subject into a case. They are for you, it's long periods of time, but then you have to get beyond that. You're not trying to find out what's wrong with them, you're just trying to sort of embrace the various aspects of them. But you do try to find out what's wrong for a long time.
The case would also be just truly understanding the dynamics, which doesn't happen to the pathology.
Yes, that's true. In that sense, you're right.
So if I could exercise the prerogative of the show, your question about media and technology and how all this is going to change biography is really a profound one, because I suspect, and I'm not saying this in an elegiac way, except that I am, but we will be the perhaps the last generation to write books of this kind, and that we will soon find ourselves in a world where information about people is conveyed through different media and in a different manner, and that biography will consist of links to video, and interviews, and other kinds of other ways of depicting a life than the one we resort to now.
But I think a good biography is still the best social history. For instance, I just read book that is coming out soon called Proust's Duchess, and it's a study of the three women that Proust based the Duchesse de Guermont on, and they were totally different from each other. And
Elizabeth de Guermont, who else?
Frances de Carmarche, and Madame Strauss, who was the widow of Bizet. And those three women, and it's a 1,000-page book, and I must have underlined every line in the whole book.
but a good biography has to be a social history. They cannot be separated. Exactly. If you're not doing that, you're not doing your job.
Thank you. You guys
have all done your job beautifully. One thing that amazes me is biographies that are adulatory of the people. I mean, like, I'm reading Katie Royfe's book called The Violet Hour, and it's about five writers and their last days. And Susan Sontag is one, and John Updike is another. And it's all adulatory. She sees nothing wrong with any of them. They're the most wonderful thing. And it's so exhilarating to read, in a way.
Well, thank you all very much.
Here.